In the last videos, we have learned spreading methods, we have learned how spreading works in general, and now we do the inverse process and despread the spread spectrum signals. And this process returns our original symbols and reconstructs them from the spread spectrum signal. Yeah, so I said this process is called despreading, and the despreading in general works that a shift sequence is extracted out of the received signal. This can be done, for example, by a demodulation. So this S-checked despreader shown here is strongly connected to direct sequence spread spectrum. We will also use direct sequence spread spectrum as an example to show the symbol reconstruction and the despreading process, but this the techniques can be applied to the other two spread spectrum methods, so the time hopping and the frequency hopping spread spectrum methods as well. But we don't go into too much into detail of these two other spread spectrum methods, so you can read a literature about reconstructing signals from them, but it's analog to the direct sequence spread spectrum. So it's what's important here is that you understand the basic principles of symbol construction and despreading. So we receive a chip sequence from the demodulator, and this chip sequence looks almost like noise until we know the original code used for spreading the signal. So we must know the original spreading code. And now we are able to reconstruct the original data. So here we have the noise-like SHIP sequence, and then we can cross-correlate them with the spreading code, and then we receive at the output here a signal which can then be fed into detector, and the detector reconstructs our original data. It can have some errors. For example, if the signal to noise ratio of the received signal is too poor, then of course the data will have errors. But if the signal to noise ratio is good, then we will probably get an error-free data stream here. And until here we have a chip sequence at the chipping rate, so at a high symbol rate, and after cross correlation, so here the code is of course at the chipping rate, and after cross correlation we get discrete symbols, or here data with a quite low bandwidth. So it's at the original data rate, and so we can also say that this is like a sample rate reduction, and in the previous chapter we said that this is downsampling. So we reduce the sampling rate from the chip frequency to the data symbol frequency, and this is like downsampling, and we can apply all the mathematics of downsampling, but it is not exactly a downsampler. We just use the mathematical models of downsampling, but it is not a downsampler. You know, downsampling would take out every nth sample from here. We don't do that. We apply a cross correlation and thereby reduce the sample rate here. But we use the mathematical model, and the most important consequence of downsampling was that we get a processing gain. And we also get a processing gain here by despreading signals. And we will see that we really get a processing gain. And this processing gain is obtained in all SPED spectrum techniques. And the processing gain is also the benefit which we have discussed in the first video, the benefit of SPED spectrum methods and the reason why we use them. And one important point is that the selection of code determines the performance of SPED spectrum. So not every code yields the desired properties, so there are differences. And the construction of spreading codes is a topic in digital communication systems, and it's an interesting topic, but we don't have time to go deep into this. So the construction of codes is out of the scope of this lecture, but you will find literature on this topic. Now let's continue with our example, direct sequence SPED spectrum. So this was our abstract despreader using the cross correlator as as its central element, and here we see the implementation of the cross correlator for the direct sequence SPED spectrum method. The cross correlator is realized by a multiplier as in the spreader. So here we use the multiplier for despreading 2. But that's not all. So we multiply here the input sample, input chips, the received chips here with the spreading code. You see this here in the example, received chips and the code. And we multiply them. But we need to integrate the multiplication here. So if you remember the definition of the cross correlation for wide sense stationary signals, then it was something like right. So and here you have the multiplication, and here you have the accumulation. So the accumulator integrates the output of the multiplication. And this is shown here in this box. So it looks very easy, but it's important because it resembles our cross-correlation function. And now let's go back to the example here. So this is the chip sequence, and here in this example it's a noise-free chip sequence. So this is exactly the data which has been generated in the example that you have seen in the video about direct sequence SPED spectrum. We use it here as an input. It's noise-free, so it is so all the chips here are correct. They are not disturbed. And now we generate the code. Of course, the code must be aligned. So the first chip is aligned with the first code here. This is important. And now we can multiply each chip with each code symbol. Yeah. Multiply, multiply, and so on. And to integrate the output. So here it's in the multiplication always yields a minus one. Here two, and so on. And what we get on the accumulator output, so all minus ones are summed up. And here at some point, our code sequence is complete. So the code sequence is 11 symbols long, 11 chips long. And this is the point where our detector evaluates the state of the accumulator. And here you see detection threshold, this orange line here. And we can say the zone in between here is an invalid state, but everything that is below the red zone is minus one, and everything which is above is a plus one. And this is what our detector does. And this is also the point where the downsampling happens. So here it's actually really a downsampling. So we accumulate here the signal here, and then we take one sample here and evaluate it. And now we map it to a discrete state, the minus one. So our output data is indeed minus one. Works. Now, after the sampling, the accumulator is reset. So and the next symbol period starts. And again, we multiply each chip with the code. And now everything gives plus one, and this is now accumulated. And at the end of the symbol period, the detector evaluates the symbol, the accumulator output, and we detect a plus one. And this was indeed our original data sequence. So it works. And it even works if there is noise in the signal. So imagine, for example, that these symbols here are wrong. Then the accumulator would rise, and then it hits the wrong symbol. It might drop, but then it still rises, and as long as it comes over the detection threshold, the detector is capable of detecting the data correctly. Same goes here for the other flipped chip here. There might be a dip, but then it returns above the detector threshold. And so now we see that some noise here, so this was an effect of noise, and this too, that some noise does not destroy our signal reception. So the spread spectrum signal is indeed immune against noise up to a certain level. Of course, if the noise is so strong that every chip is flipped and you cannot rely on the chips anymore, then the detection will probably fail. And this is what we see here with uncorrelated signals, which can be noise or disturbances from other devices or disturbances from other users or other users with their spectrum signals using other codes, for example. And here you see the most important term here. The signal must be uncorrelated. And now the loop closes to chapter 3, where we have learned about cross-correlation. And now you see where this is actually used for. And go back here. So the central part was the cross-correlator. And if we have uncorrelated signals, then we expect that these signals do not affect our signal detection. And now we have a signal which is indeed pure noise, which is the opposite of our clean signal which we had before. So this is now really random and pure noise. And now if we feed this into our receiver here, comprising a demodulator, the cross correlation, and the detector, let's see what happens. Procedure is the same. Take the received chip, multiply it with the code, and then accumulate everything. And here you see the output of the accumulator. It has some output, but it never goes far away from zero. And then we reach a point here with which is in the invalid zone of our detector, and the detector just says, oh, there's no data. And same goes for next symbol periods. Here we get also no data. Now you can imagine what happens if this noise overlaps our desired signal from the previous example here. As long as the noise is weak enough, so as long as we have a certain signal-to-noise ratio, we are still able to detect the signal, because the signal which is correlated to the code is then accumulated here and then comes over the detection threshold. And this accumulation leads us to the next point. And the benefit of spectrum signals, the processing gain. So by accumulating the signal, we increase the probability of detecting the signal correct. And this comes as with a drawback that the signal bandwidth is extended. So spectrum signals occupy a larger bandwidth. But this comes with a benefit of processing gain. So here you see the power spectral density of the received signal before spreading. Green is a noise, for example, thermal noise, which is always present in hardware, in electronics. Then we have narrowband noise, some disturbances, other signals, and so on. And then we have here our spectrum signal. And after despreading, the noise and the narrowband disturbances are not which are not correlated to the spreading code become very flat. So they are attenuated. Their power is reduced. And the SPED spectrum signal is reconstructed, and its signal power, original signal power, is reconstructed. So we have an improved signal-to-noise ratio. Here, the signal-to-noise ratio was quite low. So we had a noise-like signal, and if we take this spectrum signal, you probably cannot decode it. So in the time domain, it can look something like this, and it looks like noise. You cannot decode it. And after applying the despreading, you have very clean signal. It's maybe a bit affected by noise, but then you can. But now you see clearly the original symbols, and you can decode them. And this is described by the processing gain. And analogous to the downsampling, which we have learned in the last chapter, we can give a formula to calculate the processing gain. And it looks very similar like the processing gain achieved by downsampling. But here we use the spreading factor instead of the decimation factor. And like in downsampling, the spreading factor is the ratio between the chipping rate and the symbol rate. And you see here, the higher the spreading factor is, the higher the is the occupied bandwidth, but the higher is also the processing gain. Yeah, so if you select larger values of spreading factor, then you will get more processing gain and improve your signal to noise ratio. And this is indeed used in digital communication. So there are systems which can adapt the spreading factor to adjust to different noise situations. For example, if your cell phone is far away from the base station, then the signal to noise ratio can become so poor that signal decoding would fail. But some cell phone standards like 3G, so the UMTS standard, is capable of adapting the spreading factor, and the spreading factor is just increased, and this gives an improvement of in the signal to noise ratio, and the data detection becomes possible again. But this comes as a drawback. The UMTS signal is not allowed to occupy a larger bandwidth, so the bandwidth must be kept constant. So the parameter which must be adjusted is the data rate. So if a UMTS cell phone uses a larger value for the spreading factor, then the data rate drops. And this is what you can observe. So if you have a good signal in your cell phone, then your data rate is usually higher. And if you go more far away from the base station and the signal quality drops, then usually your data rate drops.